brain so far.
Good. Good. Welcome, everyone, and welcome to our speaker. Thank you. Professor of Economics at Sorbonne and also a board member of the Central Bank of France. She's had many different roles over her during her career. The issue she's going to speak about today is a very interesting paper put together by a number of French and German, economists on the future of the Eurozone, something that we have great interest here in this country and in this institute. The title, looking at how the sort of risk reduction part of the moving ahead can be reconciled with the risk sharing dimension of monetary union, banking union, etc. Agnes.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Thank you even more for the invitation. I'm very happy to be here to have these discussions. So I try not to be too long so that we can have an exchange, but you need to tell me when I'm skipping. Okay, so I'm going to present quickly the Franco-German report on risk sharing and risk reduction, that you have to reconcile the two concepts. Starting with the why we wrote this report. Why does the euro area need fixing? And actually, it's not so easy to understand, especially for a politician. We've met with many politicians, and one problem with the euro area, we may maybe discuss afterwards, is that it's not a good political object. It's much better to talk about security, public goods, immigration for a politician than the euro area, which seems to be very technical, and obviously you don't want to go on TV and say, oh guys, look, maybe your bank deposits are not so sure, so we are going to fix that. So why does the euro area still need fixing after years and years of reform? We identified four issues. The first one is that the financial market is still fragmented, which means that there is more instability. Suppose that there is a financial crisis, say, in Ireland. It's a purely theoretical example. The SMEs in Ireland will not have, well, less have the opportunity to get funded from other countries because of the fragmentation. So there will be more deeper crisis in Ireland due to this lack of support from other countries. And on the top of that, fragmentation means that the opportunity of the monetary union is not fully reaped in terms of better allocation of capital across the euro area. The second problem is that mutual trust has to a large extent been lost because fiscal rules are perceived as opaque and inefficient, and there are disputes over the ECB, the OMT, whether it's legitimate or not for the ECB to have this tool. And on the top of that, ESM programs have divided the countries, where both creditor countries and debtor countries seem to be unhappy. Maybe Ireland is one happy debtor country, but there is a lot of dissatisfaction, at least in Greece. Maybe also, there has been a lot of dissatisfaction, and the probability that a country would ask the ESM for help is quite low today because the political cost is very high. The third problem is that for sure there will be crises in the future. People come to me and they say, do you think there will be a new crisis in the future? Of course there will be a crisis. And the question is how to react to the crisis and minimize the cost of the crisis. And here, the macro policy toolbox is close to empty. We know that government debts are very high today. So the space to perform countercyclical policy is reduced. And on the monetary side, we know that the balance sheet of the ECB has been inflated, and it will be very difficult for the ECB to start again QE, for instance. So banks are now better capitalized, but still there is a doom loop and a conundrum between no bailout and no crisis. And this is very important in our report. If you want to make the bailout, the no bailout clause of the treaty credible, then the risk is to trigger a crisis. So we try to address this problem. And the fourth issue is the lack of macroeconomic reconvergence. The European semester is quite weak, and the medium-term surveillance is split between different processes. So this is not in the report. If we have time, I will cover that, because I think it's especially interesting for Ireland. Our proposal, so there are a number of proposals, I will not enumerate everything, but give the logic, the general logic of it. So the first idea is to make the euro area more resilient by better controlling, sharing the risk, and diversifying the risk, and by setting the conditions for a genuine banking union, where there will no longer any argument for ring-fencing of liquidity or ring-fencing of capital. So give the floor to give the possibility for development of pan-European banks, like in the US. Second idea is to strengthen the fiscal framework with more active but also more responsible fiscal policies at national level, because that fiscal policy will continue to be carried out mainly, if not only, at national level, but also to create tools at the euro area level. Third idea is to fix the institutional setup by giving more responsibility, more leeway and accountability for the ESM, who will be in charge of entirely in charge of the debt assessment and the programs, and accountable to the European Parliament. And a separation between the judge and the prosecutor. We think that it's not good that the Commission is both a judge and a prosecutor. The Commission is in charge of checking the Stability and Growth Pact, and also of making, well, it claims itself as a political body, and the two together, so we are not in favor, I will come back to that, we are not in favor of having the Commissioner for ex-fin Commissioner being the head of the Eurogroup, the chair of the Eurogroup. So, in one image, our view is that, so here you have solidarity, does it work? No, it doesn't work. Yes. Solidarity on the x-axis, responsibility on the vertical axis, and most people would think that there's a trade-off between solidarity and responsibility. And actually, the French think that we are here, a lot of responsibility, and we need to move to more solidarity. And the Germans will be here, they think that there is a lot of solidarity, they want to move to more responsibility. And what we say in the report is that we are not on this line. We are below. We are not on the possibility frontier. So we can improve on both solidarity and responsibility, and make the euro area more resilient with that. And the two go together, because if you want more responsibility, you create new risks and you need more solidarity to tackle the risk, to control them. So I will explain that in two steps. First, making the euro area more resilient, and then strengthening the fiscal framework. So making the euro area more resilient first. The idea is that risk reduction and risk sharing must go together, and give a number of examples. If you want to reduce the risks in the banks by reducing non-performing loans, by diversifying sovereign exposures, you create a risk. This is in itself, it is risky. So you need some form of risk sharing, for instance, through a deposit reinsurance to avoid a run at the time where you make the changes on the asset side, you need to secure the liability side. Second example, if you want to reduce sovereign risk, then you need to have a more responsible fiscal policies, and with high debt to GDP ratios, there is a risk that in a crisis, national governments will perform pro-cyclical policies that altogether will be self-defeating. So then there is a need for support, for some form of support from the euro area, which can come from the ESM or from fiscal capacity. So what we I will come back to that in the fiscal framework. Third example, one problem that was very evident in the case of the Greek crisis, in the middle of the crisis in 2015, for instance, there was a close relationship between the sovereign risk and the redenomination risk, in the sense that people were talking about not only the debt crisis, but also the probability that Greece would actually leave the euro area. And the risk was very high at some point. And so if you want to reduce the redenomination risk, and I think it's central to the stability of the euro area, because if you say that there's a probability that a country leaves the euro area, then immediately you have multiple equilibria and it's very unstable. So how to reduce the redenomination risk in case of a crisis? You need that all the banks in the country have access to liquidity. And we saw in the case of Greece that every week the ECB would allow a certain amount of ELA just to keep the banks afloat. Maybe something similar happened to Ireland. And it gives the ECB a lot of power, which is actually kind of political power, because the ECB will decide at the end whether the country stays, or because if the banks become illiquid, then the only solution to avoid a complete meltdown is to introduce a new currency. So this is really critical. So how to maintain bank liquidity in the middle of the crisis? You have a solution on the asset side and on the liability side. On the asset side, you need to have collateral of good quality. So the idea is to diversify the asset side, and especially the sovereign risk. So holding government bonds is very good for a bank because it gives access to liquidity. But when the government, national government, is in trouble, then the value of the collateral goes down. And then there may be a shortage of collateral, which happens actually in crisis countries. So the idea is to diversify these sovereign exposures so as, on average, to always keep good collateral on the asset side and get access to the liquidity. And on the liability side, you need to avoid a run. And there was a huge run in Greek banks. So to avoid a run, what we propose is to introduce a system of deposit insurance that would be completely transparent from the point of view of the depositor. The depositor would get exactly the same protection wherever he or she is. But from the point of view of the deposit insurance system, there would be a national compartment and a euro area compartment, and the euro area compartment would be tapped only when the national compartment is empty, which would allow for national responsibility, because there would be a cost for the national government. But it's very important to reassure the depositors. In fact, with the new bail-in rules, it's very unlikely that the deposit insurance will need to be activated. But still, you have this, and it's much more transparent for the depositor. If you tell the depositor in the street, you are safe because, you know, we have no bail-in rules, and so there is a long list of bail-inable assets before we have to tap you, it's very difficult to understand. Whereas if you say you have a deposit insurance, and if your government is foolish and does the wrong things, that you still have a European insurance, and so your deposits are insured not only by your own government, but by the whole euro area community, it's much more transparent. So the risk of a run is much reduced. And finally, how to eliminate multiple equilibria? You need the ESM and the OMT of the ECB to be credible. And so we know the OMT has never been used, in fact, and the day it will be used, there will be complaint that it is fiscal policy, not monetary policy. So to do that, to make the OMT credible, you need to separate the sovereign risk from the denomination risk, and this is really key. The problem with the status quo is that today there is no real land of last resort for the governments. There is emergency assistance with conditionalities, so there is not really a land of last resort. So, for instance, in Italy, Italian banks have been used to act as buffers. They will buy the government bonds, okay? And this, they perceive this as stabilizing, and it is stabilizing in a sense. The problem is that it makes banks vulnerable to stress on the sovereign debt market, which I just explained, because there will be a shortage of collateral. If there is a debt crisis in Italy, very soon there will be a shortage of collateral, and then the banks will be in trouble. So it makes the sovereign risk and the redenomination risk intertwined. And so the OMT, the ECB, cannot insure the redenomination risk because there is a sovereign risk inside. Okay, so you need to separate the two. And so the sovereign risk is something you accept, in a sense, a sovereign risk. You accept the idea that at some point maybe there will be need to restructure some sovereign debts. And you free the redenomination risk. The redenomination risk is purely liquidity risk. And the job of the ECB is to be a lender of last resort to the banks. It's not to finance the government, but it's to be a lender of last resort for the banks. So if you separate the two, you allow the ECB to play the role of a lender of last resort and ensure the liquidity. Of course, you never avoid a political shock where a new government would decide to leave the euro area. So this is something different. And if you never think, and this is something I've been discussing again and again with the Italians, if you never envisage at any point a debt restructuring in the euro area, then there is a problem with the treaty. Because the treaty says no monetization, no bailout. So how are you going to respect the treaty? So, of course, there is a need to be very careful about that. So our approach is not to introduce a new rule about debt restructuring, is to make debt restructuring a possibility by reducing the cost of a debt restructuring. So this is the main idea. To say that today the ESM is not supposed to lend to an insolvent country. But tomorrow, if there is a crisis, of course the ESM will lend to an insolvent country, to avoid a big crisis. We need progressively to make debt restructuring a possibility without triggering a huge financial crisis in the euro area. And at this stage, debt restructuring will be credible, but only at this stage. So in practice, how to break the doom loop? So you know the loop between sovereign risk and banking risk. The banks finance the government, and the government will help the banks in case of crisis. So already one arm of the loop has been cut with the bail-in rules, but the other part has not been cut. So as I said, so in practice what we want is to diversify the asset side of the bank's balance sheet, so through concentration charges on sovereign exposures. So there has been a lot of discussion about risk weights on sovereign exposures or exposure limits. You know that today, when a bank holds government bonds, there is no weight for capital requirements, and there is no limit. Whereas if a bank holds a private bond, there are both an exposure limit and a weight. So the idea here is not to go in this direction, because it would be very much pro-cyclical, because it depends on the rating agencies. So if the rating agencies, if a country is downgraded, then automatically the banks would be in trouble. But the idea is to introduce concentration charges. So the idea is that, so for instance, in Italy and Germany, these are the two countries where banks hold a lot of national government bonds, okay? A huge amount of their own country's bonds. And the idea is that to say, okay, you can keep them, but above a certain level, you have an additional charge. And the additional charge is the same in Italy and in Germany. It doesn't depend on the rating, because the objective is diversification. The objective is not to reduce the risk in relation with the ratings, it's to diversify. And so normally, the total holdings of sovereign bonds should not be affected. It's just the distribution across countries. So this is the idea. Of course, it's very tricky to perform it. So we have proposals to do it very progressively, maybe with the help of safe assets. So the idea to have a kind of asset that would be constructed through a bundle of national bonds and that would be exempted from the concentration charges. So it would be a way to alleviate the charge for the banks. And on the liability side, as I said, we think that European deposit insurance could be introduced even before NPLs have been reduced to minimal level. You can have fees that are different across the banks depending on the stock of NPLs. Like in an insurance, if you are a bad driver, you pay more. So so there's no contradiction with that. And what is interesting is to have it, because we think that the deposit insurance will make the transition more secure. So if you have a deposit insurance only at the end of the process, given the fact also that you have the new bail-in rules, it's less useful. It's more useful in the transition. Now, maybe I will skip the single financial market. The idea is that there is a lot to do in terms of the banking union to achieve a full banking union in terms of reducing the idiosyncrasies in national regulations, in the way resolution is applied, things like that. And on capital market union, almost everything needs to be done and give, in the first place, give more role for the ESMA, the European Securities Market Authority, that today has very little responsibility. And now I move to the second big topic, which is strengthening the fiscal framework. So maybe there are differing views in this room, but the group thinks that the record of the SGP, the Stability and Growth Pact, is quite disappointing. Technically, because there is a lot of discussion about how to measure the structural deficit, the structural balance, fiscal structural balance, and also the fact that having a SGP centered on a structural balance is still pro-cyclical to a certain extent. Economically, because we have rules that are too stringent in hard times but too lax in good times. And we see it in France today with a resumption of growth, and it's very relaxed about fiscal adjustment. And politically, because it's a good occasion for national governments to blame Brussels. So, but still, we think that fiscal rules are a necessity. Some people think that we should just abandon fiscal rules and rely on market discipline. This is not our view, because markets are often wrong, not just in the EU area. They have been wrong in Asia, for instance, in 1997. The markets just didn't see the crisis coming. So we need to think about new fiscal rules, renovating the fiscal rules. Another problem is that, as I said, the no bailout rule is still not credible. There is, in case of a no bailout, there would be high costs in terms of contagion, collateral damage. And so what should be the objective in the medium term is to allow for, in last resort, for a restructuring within the EU area, within EU. And finally, EMU lacks risk sharing and stabilization tools. So in the years to come, as I said, fiscal policy is going to be very much constrained. So if we want to avoid pro-cyclical policies, then we need to think out of the box. Today there is no fiscal stabilization at EU area level, neither at EU level. Actually, the EU budget doesn't do fiscal stabilization. And we think that public and private risk-sharing mechanisms are complements. For instance, in the middle of a crisis, it's very important to have a fiscal backing of the Single Resolution Fund. And this is how you keep the banking union together. So, responsibility and risk sharing, this is the objective. How to do it? So as I said, what is important is that sovereign debt restructuring should be a possibility in last resort when debt is unsustainable, and the ESM would say whether debt is unsustainable. Of course, there are always a gray area, but this is life. So there are technical issues about debt restructuring I will not go through. Now, the fiscal rule. So we make a proposal to change completely the SGP, to drop the reference to deficit and structural deficit, and rather adopt a spending rule, expenditure rule, which is easier to explain to the public, which says that over the medium term, government spending, nominal government spending, should grow no more than nominal GDP.
Nominal GDP.
And for countries that have a high debt to GDP ratio, spending needs to increase less. So there is a debt break, and the speed of the reduction of the debt needs to be negotiated at EU level. But this is the idea. If a government wants to increase taxation, to increase spending, no problem, but you need to rely on the independent fiscal watchdog to calculate what the tax reform will produce in terms of revenues, and to correct the spending path for that. So it allows, in fact, for much more democratic choice. You can change the spending to GDP ratio up or down. And what is interesting is that the IMF has shown that it tends to be more reliable in terms of responsibility. It's easier to explain. It relies on a measure of potential GDP growth, which is always very tricky.
But just to be clear, you're saying that expenditure can rise above nominal GDP.
No, just below nominal GDP.
But if there's a tax policy change,
yes, you change the path. So the independent watchdog would calculate the amount of additional spending that is allowed by the new tax.
Okay.
So it would adjust the path.
So it does allow a government to bring up the amount.
Okay. Yes, it allows that. So then there's the debt break. The idea is to give much more responsibility for the independent council, the fiscal council, that would be in charge of calculating the spending growth and also potential GDP growth, which is always tricky. But today, what we have is a structural deficit that depends first on potential GDP, the forecast of potential GDP, second, the forecast on GDP itself, and third, the elasticity of tax received to GDP. So there are three unknowns, and we propose to reduce to only one, potential GDP growth. And if you are wrong in terms of the position in the cycle, it's not such an issue because, for instance, you start on the top of the cycle. You didn't know that, but you are on the top of the cycle. And then, so growth will be lower than potential GDP in the future. But then it means that the debt to GDP ratio will increase. So you get that back in the rule. So I don't think this is such an issue. And on the top of that, what we say is that we should drop the sanctions, because it doesn't work. Even with the inverse rule, it will not work. And it's not very reliable to have colleagues sanctioning each other. Rather, we want a market sanction. 5 minutes? Yeah. A market sanction. So the idea is that if you deviate from your spending rule, then the excess spending will be put in an adjustment fund, like in Germany, a buffer. Mm-hmm. And if the buffer reaches 1% of GDP, then you need to issue junior bonds. And these junior bonds, subordinated bonds, that will be restructured first. In case you go to the ESM, they will be restructured. So we introduce some market discipline at the margin of the margin. Okay, and this is actually, I can afterwards in the discussion I can tell you the reaction of the French government with that. Very interesting. What I wanted to say also about the fiscal rule, yes, the good property is it's much more countercyclical. In the upturn, you want to, you have a lot of receipts, you want to spend them, but no, you cannot have the spending growth. And in the crisis, you can have a deficit of 12% of GDP. It's not a problem, if to the extent that the spending rule is respected. So more and better risk sharing. So two things here. So today we have on the one hand fiscal policy at the national level, and on the other hand we have ESM programs for crisis countries. And in between there is nothing. So we want to fill the gap for countries that, for instance, could suffer from contagion from another country, so liquidity crisis, that could be pre-qualified to get ESM funding at low cost. In case, for instance, suppose there is a crisis in Portugal and then spreads increase again, say, in Ireland, but there is no solvency problem in Ireland then, and Ireland has respected the SGP in the past years. So automatically, Ireland would be entitled to get a credit line from the ESM without further conditionality. And the second thing is for a country that is hit by a big shock. So what we propose is an increase in unemployment by more than 2 percentage points, or a fall in the employment rate by more than 2, which is far better because less prone to manipulation. Then there would be a rainy day fund that would make a transfer. So this is not a loan, it's a transfer, a one-off transfer to the country to help transfer money to the unemployed, maybe extending temporarily the unemployment duration, and keep investment, public investment alive. So we have been attacked for that because, of course, we don't propose a borrowing facility because this was a step behind. For symmetric shock, what is our response for symmetric shocks? The escape clause of the SGP. So basically, this is our response. We have already the tool, and we need to activate them. So I finish with strengthening institutions. I already talked about that. So how we address the problem? So I come back to the initial problems. In terms of financial fragmentation, what we propose is to make the conditions for pan-European banking. And we have also a chapter about capital market union. Mutual trust has been lost. We propose a more transparent fiscal rule, more national ownership because of the responsibility of the fiscal council, and more responsibility because we have these junior bonds. And also more responsibility of the ESM on debt sustainability assessment. Now, third, there will be no new crisis in the future. What are the tools? Well, we have the rainy day fund, we have ESM precautionary lines, and we have more capacity at national level for fiscal stabilization. What is left aside is macroeconomic reconvergence, and we have been criticized for that. So perhaps in the discussion I can talk about that. I've written some pieces for the European Parliament about that. It was very difficult to introduce this block in the discussion, Franco-German discussion, for obvious reasons. So we prefer to deliver on the rest, and maybe there will be at some point another piece on the macroeconomic framework. Thank you very much for your attention. Good.